can't talk about it, but Randy, I'm gonna have you come up here and welcome our people online and just say some stuff to encourage us this morning, and I'm gonna let you use my mic.
Well, thank you, Kathy. Hey, good morning, everybody. We have had a lot of stuff going on over the last few weeks, and one of the things that I loved this past weekend is we had a youth group retreat right here. And over the last 2 days, it was called the Kingdom Worker Retreat. And I was thinking about what we got out of this weekend. And I'd love for you to ask any of the kids that were here, and you can ask them if they were here, and then say, hey, what did you get out of it? But we did a lot of worship. We did a lot of fellowship. But we also spent time really just talking about what does it mean to be a kingdom worker. And one of the things that I know a lot of the kids and the adults took away from it is that it's a lifestyle. And that's what being a Christian, being a follower of Christ, is really about. It's a lifestyle. It's not a switch that you turn on and off and say, oh, it's Sunday, I'm going to be a Christian today. Or, oh, I'm going on a mission trip, so I'll be on my best and I'm going to go serve people. But it's a constant choice. And I love the fact that whether you're here today or you're online listening, you're part of this family. And that means you're a kingdom worker. And it means that you get the opportunity. You get to, you don't have to, but you get to have an attitude that is like Christ every single day, every single moment. And it's hard to do, by the way. I'm not saying it's easy, right? It's not. Matter of fact, I got caught up in the train ordeal over here. You might have seen 90 of us come in at the after. I didn't feel like a kingdom worker with that train. You know, I feel like the train people should be maybe jailed at times. But that's just my personal opinion. I'm glad a kingdom worker would say, that's okay. That's okay. But anyway, I want to welcome everybody here today. I'm glad if you're here or if you're online, welcome. We love having all of us together. This is a privilege that we get to be together every week. And as we're here, I want you to not miss something. I don't want you to miss each other either. That's one thing. Another thing we took away this weekend is it's important to have that fellowship with each other. And it's important, too, to reach out to each other during the week and encourage one another. Because, boy, it can be a lonely place if not. And so if you're online or if you're here today, boy, reach out to each other and enjoy what God has given us. I'm going to pray, then we're going to get back to worship. And again, glad you're here. I hope you are encouraged and you just walk out of here today with a big smile on your face. And by the way, if you're discouraged, and I'm just way too much in the morning for you right now, right, with this energy, which my wife says that to me a lot, and a lot of the kids did yesterday too, like, oh, you're too much in the morning. It's okay. I'm too much for myself sometimes. But I will tell you, it's really because of Jesus, because otherwise, there's just no reason to be in a good mood. But I will tell you that he makes it all worth it 24/7, 365 days a year. God, thank you for today. Thank you for this time together. And thank you for dying on the cross for us. Thank you for being enough. Thank you, God, for already being there. You're ahead of us. You're with us. And you're behind us all at the same time, God. And what an encouragement that can be. God, it doesn't have to just be us alone. It doesn't have to just be us trying to win this battle of life alone. And God, I'm sure if everybody out here, and I know they are, they're like me, there's a lot of discouragement. There's a lot of reason not to be a get-to attitude, but a have-to. And God, I pray that today you would help all of us. God, regardless if we have a smile on our face or not, God, you are enough. And God, I know that a lot of times my smile will mask over the real feelings I have, God, but I pray that we would just focus back on you. And when we realize that you're enough, that's why being a kingdom worker is real. That's why we really can be, because we don't have to do it. You've already done it. God, it's not about our good or our bad. It's not about our personality or even our attitude, God. We want to be reflective of you, though. We want people to see Jesus in us. Help us, God, today as we worship you, to look at the words, to sing them to you, and to realize that you're enough. And God, there's nothing, there's no train, so to speak, in life that can stop us, God. Thank you for who you are and what you are to us. I thank you for everybody, God, that's a part of this Harvest family, both here, both online, whether they're in Muncie online, they're in Michigan or Colorado or Washington or Hawaii or Europe, God, it doesn't matter. God, we are all part of the family of God, and we thank you for letting us hear your word and worship you together. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So I have this good friend, and her name is Izzy Rabenstein, and she's having a rough day today. She's not feeling very good, so she has to go see the doctor. So if you guys would just take some time this morning to pray for her, I know she would appreciate that, and I know God's with her, and God is good. And sometimes when you're in another country, because her parents are in Liberia right now, it's a little unsettling to have to go to the doctor. So I just pray that you would, or I would ask that you would pray, that they have peace and that they're able to get some stuff worked out today, and she's feeling awesome tomorrow. So if you do that, I know Zach and Jordan would appreciate it, and I would too.
So Good morning. Well, what a week. Beginning of the week, I was reminded, hey, you got communion meditation. And I'm like, okay, my first thought is, what in the world, God, do you want me to talk about? And so I was kind of searching through the week going, what? Nothing was coming up. And then some things started to unravel and roll. I'm like, okay, God, I think I see where we're going here. So, but before I get into this, I got to know from an audience standpoint what I'm dealing with here, okay? So I need a show of hands here. Who are animal lovers? Okay, I'm in good company. All right, hands down. I need to know the bad side here. Who are not animal lovers? Yeah. Okay, can I see that again? I need to just get real not. Okay, you're going to judge me before this is all said and done. I can promise you that. All right, now I need to go a little more specific. For those of you that are animal lovers, who are dog lovers? Okay, oh boy. All right, hands down, cat lovers? Okay, I've got more, I think, more sympathy going here than I did at South this morning. I had two at South. So I'm feeling a little more comfortable here with this. So, all right, so Wednesday morning, I'm planning to sleep in a little bit. Didn't have to go to Kokomo. So I'm like, I'm going to sleep in until about 8:30 type deal, do that thing. Well, I woke up at 7 with our one-year-old cat having a seizure at the end of our bed. I'm like, what in the world is going on? We knew she was having some eye issues. One pupil was larger than the other. Had that in the back of our heads. Well, now we're at a whole nother level, right? Call our vet. Can't get her in. So we have to go somewhere else. So found another place, and I had her there at 8:30. Like they said, came back. Double ear infection, another thing going on, and blood work came back fine, but we had a breathing issue we were a little concerned about. And so basically get her, bring her home. Next day and a half, things just aren't going any better. And it gives you just a little lethargic and so on. So Thursday night, Jenny and I decide, you know what, we're going to need to get her to the vet, and to our vet on Friday. So Jen calls, I can't go because I got to be at work in Kokomo. She's got to be at school, so we got to figure out, can Bailey take her and just see what's going on. So Jenny calls, and they're like, yeah, get her over here. I think it was like 9 o'clock. And Jenny asks, is okay if Bailey takes her? She's like, yes. And so the receptionist says, has she been here before? And Jen's like, yeah, I think Bailey's been there before. Yeah, you know. So, well, let me get some information from you. So she starts asking Jenny, long hair, short hair? And Jenny's like, oh, well, she's got long hair. And then was asked, basically, what color hair? And Jenny says, well, she's got brown hair. Then the third question is, what color is she? And Jenny goes, white? And then all of a sudden, she starts realizing, wait a minute, I think we're talking two different things here. So Jenny goes, are you talking about Bailey or are you talking about the cat? And she goes, oh, I'm talking about the cat. And she says, well, I'm telling you about Bailey. Let's start this all over again. So good thing, you know, Bailey didn't have to go in and get checked out by the vet. So that's good. So Bailey drops basically a couple guys off of school and then goes back to the vet, drops Gibby off. And by 1 o'clock, none of us have heard anything. So I'm like, what's going on? So I call the vet from Kokomo. I'm like, hey, what? I want to know what's going on. She's like, well, I got some real concerns. She said, I want to do an x-ray just for her lungs. I'm like, okay, I figured that was coming. She said, well, hang on. She said, I want to do a blood test first for leukemia, feline leukemia, which only 7% of cats get this. Okay, go for it. Let's do it. So she calls me back. She goes, I got bad news. She tested positive for leukemia. So I'm like, well, where are we at here? She's like, nah, this isn't good. So I'm like, okay. So I was like, we get an appointment set for 4:30 on Friday to have her put down. So I'm racing home to get to everyone, and we do our thing, and we get to the vet and say our goodbyes and go from there. And I'll tell you, as I was going through all this, if you'd asked me, hey, what's going on in your head? I wouldn't have said this, but after the fact, I thought back, I'm like, huh, there's been a verse popping in my head all week through this. And it was just kind of back here. And it's kind of what I was holding on to as an anchor through all this. And it comes from John chapter 16. And it really ties in with what we're about right here, right now, dealing with communion. And if you read through the whole chapter of John 16, it's talking about the work of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus is explaining to his disciples about how the Holy Spirit's going to come. And basically kind of letting them know, hey, I'm going away. Holy Spirit's going to come and take my place. They weren't getting it. He had to explain it a couple times to them. Well, then we get to verse 29 of chapter 16. I'm going to read it to the end here. This is what it says. Then Jesus' disciples said, now you are speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things and that you do not even need... Now we can see that you know all things and that you do not even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us believe that you came from God. Do you now believe? Jesus replied. A time is coming, and in fact has come, when you will be scattered, each to your own home. You will leave me all alone. Yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. And this is the verse that has stuck with me throughout the week. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have troubles, but take heart. I have overcome the world. I don't know why in the back of my head all week I had in my head, but I have overcome the world. And that has stuck with me all week long. And so as I was reading this, something else stuck out to me. The part that says, but take heart. Like, what does that mean? What does it mean to take heart? So I looked it up, and it basically means to take comfort or to be encouraged. How cool is that? Because we go through, you know, it may be a small thing, and those of you that aren't animal lovers, you're going, yeah, that's a small thing, a cat being put down, you know, that's not going to affect you like it does me, and I'm more of a dog person, to be honest, okay, just for the record, but for that, or it may be something more in our job related that's something that we're struggling with, or a family situation, or whatever. Jesus says we're going to have those, but we're to take comfort, we're to take encouragement, or to take heart. He's overcome the world. And so when we focus on that piece of it, we can get through anything. We can get through anything that comes our way because we have that promise. We have that hope. And so during this time of our service, as we stop to remember what Jesus did for us on the cross, would you just take some time and just focus on that with him and kind of gauge your heart. Where are you at? What needs to change? What do you need to give to him? Maybe you're going through a crisis. Maybe something that's equivalent in my mind of what we're going through. Maybe you're going through something else that way. Take stock in that and see where are you at when it comes to Jesus and what he did for you. Is it helping you get through it? Because as believers, as followers of Jesus, as redeemed, we have that. We have that to hold on to, and it gets us through. Would you pray with me? Dear Father, thank you for today. God, I thank you for getting us through this last week. And God, I know that as you are on your throne and you still reign because of that, God, we can have a hope in you. And we know that we can hold on to that promise, and you'll see us through. Thank you for the sacrifice Jesus made for us on the cross, that he died and that he rose. And that changes everything when it comes to our lives. We love you, and we pray this in your name. Amen.
Stand with us.
Goodness of God.
seat. Kids, you can head to the back and go to your class.
Good morning. I survived it. I made it. Got me sweating a little bit. I thought, Lord, is that you? He's always speaking, you know. We're just not always listening. God, will you help today? Will you help us to listen? Before you speak, will you help us to not hold anything back, to press into you fully, and to ask for more? There's a lot of things, God, in this life that can get our attention and it can scare us and make us think or challenge us to think that you're not in control, but you're in control. And so we trust you and we ask you to speak this morning. It's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen. Hey, you know, I don't know if I'm in the monitors. Is that what my echo is? Because I'm echoing like crazy in my own thing. Is that what it is? Am I really bringing it? Is that what it is? Brian's like, I'm listening, man. Stop yelling. Anyway, it's like I'm yelling at myself up here, but that's better. Thank you. I kind of feel like I'm spoiled in a way, because I feel like this is like a therapy session every Sunday for me, that I get to come up here and you get to hear my stories, hear my wrestling match all week long. It's like I'm on your couch, right? And I get to share with you my plight, my situation. And in some stories, you're like, okay, I've heard plenty of family stories, plenty of situations, Sam. But it's nice. I want to tell you that I enjoy it, because I don't think if I didn't have this forum, this platform, I wouldn't get to share all the things that happen to me during the week. And certainly I don't share everything with you, but I share a lot. So I get a text from my sister Ellie. And I have to tell you that it gives me great pleasure to throw her under the bus this morning. Okay, because see, as a little kid, this is really getting, I'm kicked back on the couch now. You know, she used to pick on us boys. She was the oldest, and she never got in trouble. She was always the innocent one. She was always like, I didn't do anything. I don't know what the problem is. And then we'd get in trouble. Sometimes we'd get in trouble for things she did. And she'd let us get in trouble. Then later she'd threaten us. She's going to beat us down if we told. Is anything wrong with that? Can I have anybody on my team here today? Okay, so this leads into a text that I got from her this week. Here's the text, verbatim, and I quote, that I got from her this week. She said, hey, remember when I plugged the dryer in when you were working on it and almost electrocuted you? Smiley face. She put a smiley face on that. End of quote. My response was, yes, that was wonderful, ... And that was it. That was the extent of our conversation. No, hey, brother, I'm proud of you. I love you. Hey, you're doing awesome. Hey, keep it up. You know, I'm sorry about this. But ha, 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 remember when I almost electrocuted you? Let me tell you the rest of what happened. She asked me if I could come and look at a problem that she was having with her dryer. She lured me into the garage where it was at. It was nighttime. And as I'm working on her problem, she decides to try to take things into her own hands. And while I'm on one end of the plug-in, she, for some reasons, decides to plug the dryer in. And I'm telling you, there was a fantastic electrical blue light that took place right in front of me, and a big black mark on the dryer, and everything went dark because it blew the breaker. And I'm like, in the dark, I turned toward her. She goes, did I do that? Did you do that? You almost did. I almost died. What in the world are you doing? And we had a conversation. It wasn't a very nice conversation. Now, when I'm working, I've learned something. When I'm working on something that could kill me, I don't ask for Ellie's help anymore. Not really. I didn't really, come to think about it, ask for her help that time either. She just decided to be helpful and plug the dryer in when I'm working on the other end of it. Listen, we don't always ask for what we get. Sometimes God just gives it to us, and this is going to be one of those days, I think. It's going to be one of those times when we meet with God and God gives us something that we don't necessarily always ask for, but we need. We've been in this sermon series called Spoken, and the gist of that series, if you're just catching on, is that we've been asking God, God, will you speak over us and give us something that you, from your heart, God, to my heart, what is it that you want me to focus on? What is it you want me to really, to zone in on, God, that you want to speak over me, this word or this thing? And I asked you, oh, so many months ago, to start sending these words to me, right? And some of you sent me some doozies, and it's been pretty incredible, actually. I've told you I was going to put out the list. Maybe I'll try to do it this next week when the series is over. I'll let you look through the list of what everybody in here that has sent to me. And I'd ask you to keep them coming. I'm interested in what God's speaking to you. And I'd ask you not to make a mistake by closing off your heart and saying, God, I've heard enough. Don't speak anymore. Ask God to continue to speak to your heart because he has a lot to say. The word, it's interesting because I was wrestling with what word to end on, right? It's our last sermon in this series. What, I want it to be a good one, and I was wrestling through the list, and somebody asked me if I'd come up with that word yet. Hey, have you come up with a word for this week yet? And I said, no, not really. I'm kind of just thinking about it. And they said, you ought to do the word listen. And what was so odd about that is, that was, what are the chances of this? That was the very first word sent to me when I started this whole thing a couple months ago. The very first word that was texted me by one of you was the word listen. And I think it's so fitting that we talk about it today because it's so important. It really didn't appeal to me at first, but then when God got my attention by somebody out of the blue suggesting, without seeing the list, that the word should be listen, and it's the very first word that God had somebody send to me, I think he intended for me to speak about this word, this idea, this thought of listening. And when God does something like that, I think we should pay attention. Listening may be the greatest struggle that man has that affects our relationship with God the most. And as I kind of wrestled with this word after I said, I just decided in my heart, man, this is the word for this week, I started thinking about how much power God has. As I started thinking about how much power God has who commands the lightning, this question came to my heart. Are we afraid of getting electrocuted? Is that why we struggle staying plugged into his presence? Is it the power that he has? Are you afraid to listen to God? Are you afraid to hear his voice? Are you intimidated by God? Sometimes God's love can be so powerful that I wonder if we don't want to listen. We don't want to. We want to limit our intake of your voice, and so we shut him off and we say, that's enough. Haven't you taken some vacations from the voice of God before in your life? When you say, okay, God, I don't want you to speak anymore to me. Doesn't that come from a fear? A fear of what we might hear from him, what he might say, what he might ask of us. How about this? Do you not want to listen to God because you're afraid of what he might ask you to give up? Now tell me that hasn't been a limit in our communication with God. Tell me that's not something that all of us can't relate with. God, I love it. I want to come to church, but I've kind of stayed at a distance, and this COVID thing's kept me at a distance, and it's been kind of nice because you're not so loud. And I can kind of be in charge of what, and you don't throw these curveballs at me that you want me to change something. I guess it needs to be an active relationship where I'm listening to you all the time, God. What if God speaks something to us that costs us our life, our plans, our comfort, what we like? I mean, isn't ignorance bliss? Don't they say that? What if I just don't hear what you're saying, God? Am I innocent? Am I excused? Does my ignorance help me out in your conviction and help me out later in life? Didn't you do that as a kid, right? Your parent yelled out, take out the trash, and you pretend like you didn't hear? Are we doing the same thing to God? Are we afraid to listen? I want you to consider some things this morning about this idea of listening to God, and I want you to ask yourself some questions this week, not just this morning, but this week, and here's some questions you can ask. Are you afraid to ask for God's help? Are you afraid to listen for God or to God? Are you afraid for Him to speak to you? Has there been some issue in your life where you have stopped trying to listen to God and for God? Have you buried it just so deep that it's deafened your ears toward God and you don't even know that's what it is? I want you to turn in your Bibles to Exodus. Exodus chapter 19. We're going to be in that verse today, or that chapter today. Exodus chapter 19. We're also going to go into chapter 20. And we're going to read that text. There's just an incredible story that's found there, and it basically is depicting, it's sharing a huge mistake, I believe, that God's people made that we can be challenged with and also we can learn a lot from. And I want to give you a little bit of background to this story. This is the Sinai Peninsula. And the Sinai area in Mount Sinai, this is where we're at. And something that I have to recognize, and some of you people who've walked in the church for a long time need to recognize, people don't always know the stories of the Bible like you think they do. And so sometimes when we're sharing and we're referencing things, I want you to be aware of that. It's just free. It's not even part of my message. I just want you to recognize and be aware that people don't always know the stories. Oh, you know? And they will say, oh, yeah. But they really don't know the story. So throughout the whole Old Testament, just to give you some background, God and man were together in the Garden of Eden, and that is exactly how God wanted it to be. It was his plan, his desire, to be with mankind forever. This is it. And because of man's choice to disobey, it brought separation between God and man. And the entire Old Testament is one theme, one song, one story, and it's this. I'm coming to get you. I'm coming for you. You're mine, and I'm coming for you. And so the stories might change in the Old Testament, but it's the same message from God. God saying to mankind, I'm coming to get you. And at different times, God had these people, right, were God's people, the Israelites, the Hebrews. They were God's chosen people that he showed his favor to, that he disciplined like children, that he blessed, that he did all these things with to let mankind see that he wants a relationship and what it means to have a relationship with God, and also what God's character is like and who we are. Because if you don't know who we are, we don't know who God is, there's going to be a disconnect, right? And then throughout the stories in the Bible, it's God showing kindness again, showing favor to his people. Then when they disobeyed, God would turn them over to be taught a lesson. And so there was a time when the Israelites, God's Hebrews, God's people, were put into slavery in Egypt. And for 400 years, they were in this slavery. And it was a miserable slavery. And they were being treated so harshly and so, it was devastating, that finally they humbled themselves and cried out to their God and said, God, we can't take this no more. And God provided, said, I'm going to come, and I'm going to get you out of slavery. You've repented, you've turned, you said, okay, help me. And so they reached up, and God always reaches down when we reach up. Pretty cool about God. Know that that always happens. And so you know the story, right? God brought them out of that slavery into the Sinai Peninsula, into the wilderness somewhat, but toward the promised land. And what we're reading right now is actually God bringing them to this place because God wanted to speak to them. And ironically, it's the very same place that God spoke to Moses in the burning bush. And God said, hey, Moses, as Moses was wandering around in this desert, right, the same desert, God appeared to him in this bush that burned but didn't burn up. And he said, take your sandals off. You're standing on holy ground. I'm sending you to my people in Egypt, and you're going to do all these things, and you're going to lead them out, and I'm going to do something to the Egyptians that you're not going to believe. It's going to be amazing, but they're going to come out, and they're going to come to this place, to this Mount Sinai, and I'm going to speak to them. It's the very same place that a few years after this, God would whisper to a certain prophet named Elijah, who was pretty devastated and was running from his calling and where God had him. And God whispered right to him after some events in that cave up on the mountain. It's the same place. He said, what are you doing here, Elijah? Go back. Go back. So this is where we're at. And I want you to know this place where God has spoken so many years ago, he's still speaking from. And this morning, today, he brought you to this place so that you would hear his voice speak to you this morning. And I pray that God does that, and I pray that you're listening. So we're going to read down through this bit of scripture here, starting verse 19. Verse 1 of chapter 19. And then I'm just going to stop, and I'm going to share some observations that God gave me, I think, or that I had, that I think might benefit or challenge us in our walk with God, in our desire to listen to God, or our need to listen to God. So, on the first day of the third month after the Israelites left Egypt, on that very day they came to the desert of Sinai, after they had set out from Rephidim. They entered the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, this is what you are to say to the descendants of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt, and how I carried you out on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. I have to stop because I feel like I need to tell you something that maybe you've never been told. Maybe you've been told it before, but you've never listened to it. Maybe you've never heard it. And so I feel like I want to stop right now, and I want to tell you what God's intentions are for you. Isn't that interesting? You came in, I don't know what you came looking for today, but what you're getting today is you're getting the greatest question that mankind wants to know, you're getting that answer today. God, what are your intentions with me? Here's his intentions. He wants you to be his treasured possession. Isn't that awesome? Isn't it something that the creator of the universe, who created the stars and the galaxies and the sun and the moon and all these animals, these incredible animals that are on this planet, and of all created things, even the angels, he says, no, I want that one down in the mud. I want that disobedient one. I want that dirty, filthy one. I want that one that keeps running from me. That right there. What are you talking about? If somehow we could be in the place where God and you could have a conversation about God's vision, about God's view, and you'd say, God, did you really see what they did last week? Did you see what they have done their whole life to you? Did you see what they don't want you? But God would say, no, listen, I'm gonna pay everything for them. I'm gonna give up everything for that one right there. And I just desperately, what I want is I want them to be my treasured possession. That's God's intentions when he looks at you. It has not changed from the beginning of the world. And it'll never change, no matter what you do. No matter how fast you run, how hard you run, no matter what you do, you will always be God's desired, treasured possession. It's unbelievable, isn't it? And I know you know what that is, right? Some of you have a treasured possession, something that you won't let anybody else touch, something that if somebody came in and they stepped on it, stomped on it, threw it away, broke it, you would be so furious with them. I want you to wrap yourself around this truth. That you are God's most treasured possession. And there's nothing that's more satisfying or better that you can be in this life than God's treasured possession. Are you listening this morning? The text goes on. These are the words that you are to speak to the Israelites. So Moses went back and he summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words that the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together, "We will do everything that the Lord has said." So Moses brought their answer back to the Lord. The Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you." Then Moses told the Lord what the people had said. And the Lord said to Moses, "Go and to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day." You know, there's so many patterns in the Bible. Do you find it interesting that Jesus came and he washed our linens as white as snow, took our sins away, that he consecrated us, that he prepared us, that on the third day when he defeated death, our sins were all gone and we were already consecrated by that day. And he presented us to God and he speaks to the Father in our defense. Isn't it cool? Isn't it beautiful? On this mountain, God is saying something that was going to happen and also he wants to do even now. It's so powerful. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day, because on that day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. I want to stop and tell you something. Listening doesn't just accidentally happen. I started thinking this week about the effort of listening. Hearing God, it's something that you have to seek. It's something that you have to actively prepare to do. It's a desire thing. It's an effort thing. You're not going to accidentally listen to God. Do you know that? You're not going to accidentally listen to God. I'm not saying that God's not speaking. I'm not saying that God hasn't spoken through tragedy, a car crash, cancer, some crazy thing, and got your attention. I'm not saying you haven't heard the boom. I'm saying to actually listen to what God's saying about you. It takes effort. You're not going to accidentally listen to God. It's a forward step thing. It's not something that happens when you sit back moping around about your failures in your life. It's not a backpedaling thing, living in the darkness. And here's why. Because this world will never allow you to listen to God for free. This world will never allow you to hear God, to listen to God. Let me read on. God goes on, he said, put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you do not approach the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain is to be put to death. They are to be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on them. No person or animal shall be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they approach the mountain. Listen, you don't like this, what I'm about to say. And definitely the people you're reaching out to don't want to hear this, but I'm going to tell you the truth. God sets the rules, not you. God sets the rules, not you. And quite frankly, it's the best that he sets the rules because his perspective is not from the valley, but from on high. And you might not like what he says and how he sets the boundaries up and the rules that he sets out, but they are the best. And let me go a little further now that I've thrown that at you. God has not invited you. He's not invited you to a negotiation table where your grievances are heard or your terms of relationship are heard. His invitation has not been so that he can listen to you and some frustrations that you have, as if you have something to offer. This is why so many people are disappointed with God. Because of his silence. Because God didn't ask when I demand. I said, I'm here. I've got some things to say. You've got some explaining to do before I give you anything, before I talk to you. You want me to come? You better beg me to come that direction. I've heard for how many times that you've got this invitation for me, and you want me to come to your table. Well, yeah, there's going to be a table. I'm going to set it before the table because we got some talking to do. I've actually had people tell me that. God's got some explaining to do. And you know what? I'm looking forward to meeting him in heaven because before I got some things to tell him. You want to know where people are at? You want to know why they're having a hard time listening to God, hearing God? It's because their arms are crossed and they're frustrated and they're mad and they're angry at God and they don't understand. And God gives them an invitation. They say, sweet, about time I got this invitation and I can't wait to give you an earful, God. I want to give you a heads up. I want to tell you what the table is that he's invited you to. It's actually a banquet table. It's not a negotiation table. He's already done that. It's a banquet table where he wants to tell you some wonderful things. And he wants to overwhelm you with some blessing. And so the invitation is to a banquet table. Are you listening? Are you interested? The story goes on. After Moses had gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them, and they washed their clothes. Then he said to the people, prepare yourselves for the third day. Abstain from sexual relations. On the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain and the very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in a fire. The smoke billowed up like the smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder. Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. The Lord descended to the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. Can you imagine seeing Moses walk toward that trembling mountain and that smoke-filled and fire-filled mountain and watching his back disappear in the haze? How tremendous that must have been. Moses, are you crazy? He called him to the top of the mountain, so Moses went up. And the Lord said to him, go down and warn the people so that they will not force their way through to see the Lord, and many of them will perish. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves, or the Lord will break out against them. You have to know this. You have to pay attention to this. God is not playing. We're so cavalier. We're so arrogant. Even in our humility, we're arrogant. God is not playing. He is not to be taken lightly, but his love is gentle and it can be trusted. And your approach to God matters. It has such a huge impact on your ability to hear, but not just to hear, but to listen to God's love. Our arrogance, mankind's arrogance, will never allow us to hear the love song that God bellers from the top of that mountain. And the tones and the beauty of it drowns the valley and reaches into the darkest places and sends a message of hope out that God is on high and God wants to speak and God wants to tell you something. Do you want to listen? Do you want to hear what God has to say? The story goes on. Moses said to the Lord, the people cannot come up on Mount Sinai because you yourself warned us. Put limits around the mountain and set it apart as holy. The Lord replied, go down and bring up Aaron with you. But the priest and the people must not force their way up through to come up to the Lord, or he will break out against him. Listen to the advice and accept discipline, and at the end you will be counted among the wise. I started thinking, man, patience brings God's voice. Or maybe it brings it into tune. Maybe God's voice is speaking all the time, isn't it? And maybe it's the patience that allows us to tune in to his voice. I think listening is a practice, and we need to be willing to accept God's discipline to get to God's wisdom. And too many people turn their ear away from God when they hear something they don't like, or they hear something that challenges them. Or if it's not in their timing, how many of you have given up on God's voice because it wasn't in your timing? That we start defining God's goodness based on how quickly he responds to us. That we start defining and measuring God's love and his capacity and what he's doing based on the results of our lifespan. The results of what we're experiencing now and the trouble and the hardship that we're going through. Must be God's deaf. Must be God's not listening. Must be God's not talking. Must be God has forgotten about me. We don't go to this. God, you are faithful and you are just. And my life is like, we're like sheep to be slaughtered. God, my life is given up. I give it up for whatever. I'm listening to you, God. Use tragedy. Use whatever you want to use for your glory, to have your fame and your name spread across this dark valley. turn an ear from God's voice and we stop listening because we don't like what we hear. And we say we're not prideful. Who actually think it's God is the prideful one? Because he didn't negotiate with us and didn't really ask us what we needed. Has it ever occurred to you that God already knew what you needed before you were born? And his grace is sufficient, for his power is made perfect in your weakness and in your failure and in your crazy. And your only hope is to turn your ear to God and say, God, you're speaking, I'm listening. Help me to be silent. Help me to be still in your presence. The text goes on. Chapter 20, jump to verse 18, I think it is. But I could have my numbers off here. When the people saw the thunder and the lightning and they heard the trumpet and they saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. And they stayed at a distance. And they said to Moses, speak to us yourself, and we'll listen. But don't have God speak to us anymore, or we're going to die. Can't you feel the mistake that we've made? Can't you feel the mistake that we've made, that mankind's made, that was made there that day when God decided, wow, the people said they'll do whatever I want, whatever I ever ask them. Go down and consecrate them on the third day. I'm going to come down the mountain to them, right to the edge, and I'm going to let them hear my voice. Just like they did in the cool of the day in the garden. I'm going to speak to them. And God's most treasured possession is so fearful and so afraid that they beg God not to speak to them anymore. What a mistake we make in asking God not to speak. See, what you think and what I think and what the people you're reaching out to think is we think that we can keep ourselves safe by staying at a distance from God. You know, there's no place you can hide. There's no place you can go to that's away from God's presence. But we think, well, wait a minute, I'm going to be my own refuge. And if I could just keep God at a distance, then isn't it interesting? When you're hurt and when you're broken and your family has troubles or whatever, that you turn bitter and you start blaming God and you start distancing yourself from God. Haven't you noticed that that's the pattern? That's what we do. We think that somehow if we can just stay at a distance from God, we believe that everything's going to be fine if we just protect ourselves and we keep God away from us. Then we wonder why we can't hear his voice. God, where'd you go? And in the same breath, we're saying, there is no God. I haven't heard him. He doesn't speak to me. I don't hear him. Has it dawned on anybody that God's silence in our life is nothing more than him honoring our request for his silence? Have we settled for listening to man's voice because we're afraid of God's voice? And we don't even know it. There's two more verses I want to read to you. But before I read those things to you, I have to share with you, I feel like all this other stuff. Have you ever, it feels like drinking from a fire hose. Well, that's what I experienced this week. And God just kept piling things on, scriptures and thoughts and scriptures and thoughts. And it's like on this topic of listening, and I just like, wow, it's too much, God. And so the only thing I can think about doing is just passing along the too much to you. Aren't I a nice guy? And so I want you just to sit and I want you just to listen to some things that I feel like God wants me just to throw at you. And if you need reference to some of these scriptures that I share and some of these things that I share, you can ask me later, or you can just listen to it back online and think about it. In Proverbs 19, it says, listen to my advice and accept discipline, and at the end you will be counted among the wise. In Proverbs 1, it says, let the wise hear and increase learning, and the one who understands obtain guidance. In James, it says, know this, my beloved brothers, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Back in Proverbs, it says, stop listening to instruction, my son, and you will stray from the words of knowledge. In Luke, Jesus said, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. In Romans, Paul says, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. In James, back in James, it says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what it says. In Matthew, Jesus says, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who builds his house on the rock. Back to Proverbs again, it says, my son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my wisdom. Listening is your only chance to finding God. Your mouth is your ear's greatest enemy. Your desires get in the way of what you need. Your flesh is against your spiritual needs. Listening is nothing more than a battle of the wills. To listen is to trust. Question that came to my mind, in my heart, is a grand question. It's a great question. People should be asking it. Maybe you should ask it. Why is it so easy to listen to the world and so difficult to listen to God? I'm going to give you the answer before you even wrestle with the question. And it's this: because the world tells you what you want to hear and doesn't care if it kills you or even is good for you. Did you get that? Why is it so easy? Why is it so tantalizing, so awesome to listen to the world? Why do your children, why do your friends, why do your coworkers just blend in and listen to the world like crazy? Then you, they don't want to listen to. God, they don't want to listen to. Why? Because the world tells you what your itching ears want to hear. It tells you what feels good to the flesh, and it doesn't care if it kills you. Misery loves company. Satan is miserable, and he is the ruler of this world. He's got people trying to tell you things, and it's so much easier to listen to them, but difficult to listen to God. In Luke, I'm going to ask the musicians to come up because we have an invitation. It's going to be a little bit different invitation today. We're going to sing a song, and I'll tell you what that invitation is when I finish out here. I'm going to ask you to do something today. But in Luke chapter 9, verse 44, by the way, I haven't forgot about the last two verses I want to read to you. I'm holding that because I feel like that's at the crossroads of your decision that you need to make. In Luke 9, 44, Jesus said this: let these words sink into your ears. I want you to know that we choose what we hear many times of God's truth. That we choose how we listen many times. It's a choice that we're making to reject God's clear, crystal clear, incredible voice. If you don't think that's true, I want you to think about Judas. Judas heard every one of Jesus' sermons, but he didn't listen. Right? Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. God has come. God has come. Isn't that great? Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you. not afraid of God, the fear of God. It's a different thing. Look up the difference. So that the fear of God will be with you and it'll keep you from sinning. In other words, it'll keep you from walking away like you're choosing right now to do. Verse 20. The people remained at a distance. While Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. Can you see the crossroads? See the decision that we're placed, that's placed before us, that God has come to the mountain, to this meeting place, to offer you, is the opportunity to step toward the mountain, toward the voice of God, to turn your ear toward Him, or to remain where you're at, or even to go the other way. That's the crossroads we're at. And so everyone in here is different. You all are in a different place with God. Some of you are like, I don't know what this message is about, because you know, I'm listening to God and God's got me and I got Him and I love it. Some of you don't have a clue, and you just need to fall on your knees and ask God, God, speak, please help me to listen. But wherever you're at, this is the challenge. This is my little desire, to have you respond to God in a good way and to say, God, we're hearing you, we're listening. You don't have to come all the way up here. There's this beautiful scripture that says, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. And so at this crossroads moment, if it's just a pew forward, if it's just one pew forward, I would love to see all of us take a step forward toward God, knowing what He'll do. Maybe some of you need to come all the way to the altar, I don't know. But maybe some of you just need to come a pew forward, just as a message to God that's clear. God, I'm not going anywhere, and I'm listening, and I need to hear from you. So that's the invitation to move. The invitation of God. Will you stand? Will you move? The darkness is terrified of your Savior. Terrified, literally. And already defeated. But I think what shakes the darkness is when you move toward your Savior. That's what shakes the darkness, quite honestly. Because you have a larger than a rhino God who is stampeding toward you, his child, that's taken a single step toward him. And there's nothing in this world that can withstand the holy presence of your Redeemer. Stand up. Stand up. Recognize who you are. Stop running from the voice of God. God has something to say. And it's not a conversation that you think it's going to be. It's not all this garbage that you're dealing with. It's a lot of love and a lot of affection and a lot of blessing and a lot of feeding and a lot of just overflow. See, the arms of the Redeemer are, they don't even hesitate. They're not, the darkness doesn't even slow them down. And that's how he feels about you. It's pretty crazy. Oh, really, Moses? The people said that? Hey, tell them I'm coming down a little further down the mountain and I'm just really going to share and they're going to hear my voice. I can't wait. I'm coming for them. Stop living defeated if you're redeemed. Start living in joy and start living in victory. And if you're not redeemed, he paid everything for you. Run to him. He's got something that you're going to love. God, thank you for this holy moment that only you can make happen. God, we're listening. Help us to listen more. God, help us to do whatever it takes to tune this world out. It's telling us just lies because we want to believe those lies so much, God. That's our confession. And sometimes we do. Sometimes we believe the truth of those lies more than we do your voice. Forgive us for that. Thank you. Your presence is beautiful. Your voice is beautiful. We love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Have a good day.